The Lord shatters the cedars of Lebanon.
He makes Lebanon's promises to be like a calf. He gives his mountain her beauty like a young.
The voice of the Lord strikes with bolts of lightning. The voice of the Lord twists mighty oaks and strips the forest bare. In this temple, everyone shouts, glory!
The Lord rules
over
the harvest. The Lord reigns
as king forever. The Lord gives his people strength. The Lord blesses them with peace. The second lesson is from Romans chapter 8, verses 12 through 17. Therefore, dear brothers and sisters, you have no obligation to do what your sinful nature urges you to do. For if you live by its dictates, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba Father, for his Spirit joins our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. And since we are his children, we are his heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share his glory, we must also share his suffering. The word of God, the word of life.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John, chapter 3. There was a man named Nicodemus, a Jewish religious leader who was a Pharisee. After dark one evening, he came to speak with Jesus. Rabbi, he said, we all know that God sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are evidence that God is with you. Jesus replied, I tell you the truth, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. What do you mean, exclaimed Nicodemus. How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again? Jesus replied, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it wants. Just as you can hear the wind but can't tell where it comes from, where it is going, so you can't explain how people are born of the Spirit. How are these things possible? Nicodemus asked. Jesus replied, you are a respected Jewish teacher, and yet you don't understand these things? I assure you, we tell you what we know and have seen, and yet you won't believe our testimony. But if you don't believe me when I tell you about earthly things, how can you possibly believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ever gone to heaven and returned, but the Son of Man has come down from heaven. And as Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. God sent his Son into the world, not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
God bless our native land, firm may she stand through storm and night, when the wild tempests rage. So shall our prayers arise to God above the skies. On him we wait. Thou who art ever nigh, guarding with watchful eye, to thee aloud we cry, God save the state.
To the 6th day of June, which was Operation Overlord on D-Day. So that we won't hear about. We'll do that on another time. Well, thank you for being here today. I am deeply honored to stand with you commemorating the sacrifices of those military men and women who have laid down their lives in service to this nation. I would like to take a moment and acknowledge any of those among us who have lost a loved one in the line of duty to this country. It does not matter how much time has passed, no words of condolence can even begin to adequately console a survivor's grief. Let me say that I have the greatest respect and appreciation for their contributions and their sacrifice. And we are proud to honor them today. On Memorial Day, we often find ourselves reflecting on those individuals who so bravely and instinctually risked life and limb in the face of grave danger. It is, of course, fitting today that we remember the valiant actions of the more than 600 posthumous Medal of Honor recipients, those who selflessly sacrificed their lives in an attempt to save their comrades in arms. Being a military veteran means you sacrificed a number of hours of your life for the orders and the privilege of obeying those orders from those of a higher rank than you. It meant performing endlessly numbers of push-ups and sit-ups, or hiking countless miles while wearing too many rucksacks on your back. It meant drills and or grass drills, shooting ranges, etc., GI parties, and the favors for those GI parties were sponges, brooms, and mops. And of course, the field trips. More times than not, they were in the rain or the cold. It meant mind-numbing hours on guard duty or kitchen patrol. And if you had managed to earn yourself extra duty by breaking one or more of the numerous regulations, you had up to 22 hours a day of the same mind-numbing work, followed by a generous offer of 2 hours of sleep, and then you did it all again the next day. Being a U.S. military veteran also means you were willing to fight and die in service to your country. It meant being separated from friends, the family, and loved ones. It meant giving up control of your life to others and having to trust your well-being to them. It meant that you took an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States, and you lived up to your part of that bargain. This Memorial Day, we are again reminded of the tremendous sacrifice endured to ensure America's freedom. Our military bravely and proudly carried the burden of defending this country, and for that, there are not enough words to express our gratitude. Because of them, this country remains the greatest nation on this earth. And I think those men and women who so long ago imagined this holiday, what we now call Memorial Day, they knew what they were doing when they designated this time of the year as our time to honor our fallen. It's a time of renewal and strength after a long winter. They must have imagined all the flowers in bloom, a million or more, representing those lost and others here and on almost every continent around the globe. They must have imagined the opportunity to tell the stories of the past to the American people who will pass these stories on to the children of tomorrow. Together, we gather at cemeteries, monuments, and parks all over the country. We march in parades in cities big and small, from Hawaii to Virginia, from Alaska to Texas, and we watch the annual Memorial Day concerts on our televisions. We do these things to honor the loyalty and bravery of our fallen in this noble calling, military service. While this day is typically spent recalling the valor of men and women who died in combat, we must never forget those quiet professionals that answered the noble calling to serve the people of the United States in peacetime as well. The history of our nation and those who served can be summed up in a short and simple, yet fitting phrase. They are ordinary people who, by nature of the service and sacrifice, are extraordinary. Men like Army Chaplain Captain Abel Capon, who grew up on a small farm in Pilsen, Kansas. His first calling was to God. God, he said, called him into the military service. So he joined the Army. Captain Capon was sent to Korea in 1950 to provide comfort and counsel to the troops as a chaplain during the first months of the Korean War. The soldiers quickly realized he was so much more than a chaplain. He was their saint soldier. On All Saints' Day, his unit came under heavy attack by Chinese forces. Capon had the chance to fall back to safety with a portion of his unit, but he chose to stay in the thick of the battle to minister to the dying and aid the wounded. He would brave a barrage of bullets bounding from foxhole to foxhole to check on his boys. Over and over, he risked his life to retrieve the wounded or the bodies of the fallen. When the wounded were beyond saving, he gave them spiritual comfort. Despite finally being captured and in the midst of being marched away by a Chinese soldier at gunpoint, Captain Caban saw an enemy soldier with his weapon drawn and moments away from executing an American soldier. Captain Caban defiantly left his captor, pushed the enemy soldier to the ground, and then picked the soldier up from the ditch. The enemy troops were too stunned to react. Captain Caban spent the rest of his time in the war interned in a prisoner of war camp in North Korea, where he died in 1951. And was posthumously presented the Medal of Honor by the President at the White House on April 12, 2013. And what's amazing about this story is that Captain Caban did not shoulder a rifle or wield a bayonet. He carried a Bible and some holy water. These are the weapons he used in battle, and they were more effective than the bullets of a determined enemy. His death was a tragedy, but his life is what we must learn from. On Memorial Day, a tradition dictates that the Stars and Stripes are raised briskly against the wind to the top of the staff, then solemnly lowered to the position of half staff, where it remains only until noon. It is then raised to full staff for the remainder of the day. The half staff position remembers the more than 1 million men and women who gave their life in service to their nation. At noon, their memory is raised by the living, who resolved not to let their sacrifice be in vain, but to rise up in their stead and continue the fight for liberty. So many mothers, so many wives, husbands and fathers, extended family and friends do their duty every day to ensure their loved one is remembered. They carry on each day with pictures on mantles and mementos of a life not fully lived. They carry on understanding that their soldier chose this life of service, and thus they understood the potentiality of their death as a sacrifice for the sake of freedom. These men and women left behind carry on their soldiers' message, raising up their memory like an unfurled flag. Today, we also honor the families of those lost, for you bear a burden that you can comprehend. We are grateful for the support you gave your soldiers, so they could carry out the mission of protecting the rest of us. It is our responsibility as citizens to remember the nation's brave fallen men and women, whether on foreign land, in the heat of battle, or after a lifetime in the uniform of our armies. Never forget. Never forget the men and women who know all too much the cost of our freedom for their service to this country is the greatest gift of all. President Kennedy once said, "A nation reveals itself not only by the men it produces, but all the men it honors, the men it remembers." Of course, today, we equally honor servicemen and women, but the sentiment remains the same. and crystal clear. A key component to our nation's greatness lies in our ability to honor, appreciate, and cherish through our actions and our memories all those who died and served to ensure our freedom. Again, thank you for letting me be a part of this ceremony. God bless those deployed in today's harm's way, providing us the opportunity to enjoy this beautiful day in our great nation. God bless our nation through these challenging times, and God bless each of you. Now, if you'll just hang with me for a couple of minutes, I came across a piece of music written by Lee Greenwood, and I am not going to sing it. And I'm proud that these are my views, and I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I'd gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, because there ain't no doubt that I love this land. God bless the USA. A prayer for our veterans, please. This may not come off too well. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, you have blessed us with brave men and women who are willing to defend our freedom. May your protection and grace surround them each day. Let their healing hand be upon those who suffer wounds and injuries. May those who have made the ultimate sacrifice rest forever in your holy presence. Comfort the families who mourn and are left to remember the precious lives of their loved ones. Help us to honor and support them. Let us ever be mindful of each sacrifice made on behalf of the American people by our sons, daughters, husbands, wives, mothers, fathers, and friends. Amen. One last statement. If America lost all of its soldiers, it would be like God losing his angels. Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we remember those who have made the ultimate sacrifice for the freedoms we enjoy every day, we think of how they have followed in the footsteps of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Please hold our servicemen and women in your strong arms. Cover them with your sheltering grace and your presence as they stand in the gap for our protection. We also remember the families of our troops. We ask for your unique blessings to fill their homes, and we pray your peace, provision, and strength will fill their lives. May the members of our armed forces be supplied with courage to face each day, and may they trust in the Lord's mighty power to accomplish each task. Let our military brothers and sisters feel our love and support. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I once was lost.
was grace that taught.
Powerful experience that will generate through you a more just